Now we'll move on to speech number four. It will be CC2 by Toastmaster Ilangi Thiringa. I request Harini to give the speech.
The objectives of project number two, organize your speech, are select an appropriate outline which allows listeners to easily follow and understand your speech, make your message clear with supporting material directly contributing to that message, use appropriate transitions when moving from one idea to another, create a strong opening and conclusion. Timer, the time is 5 to 7 minutes. All the best.
He's a dangerous person. Whenever he's on stage, he gets a rebound. He knocks the competition out very clearly. A quality manager and program management executive, a professor over years, and has a lot of hobbies. Photography, travel, badminton, public speaking, etc., etc., his passions. Very active on social network, loves making friends, and always managed to do something special when pushed to a corner in life. Welcome, Lingadir. CC2 turns cars into stars.
Some of the best music was composed by Beethoven. What was his handicap? He was deaf. Some of the best poetry on nature was written by John Milton. What was his handicap? He was blind. One of the world's greatest leaders was US President Franklin D. Roosevelt. What was his handicap? He served from a wheelchair. Toastmaster of the day, Toastmasters and guests, good afternoon. Read the life histories of people who turn negative into positive, adversity into advantage, stumbling blocks into stepping stones. There is one common factor: they refuse to let disappointment and failures pull them down. Wilma Rudolph was born in Tennessee in the United States of America, poor family. At the age of 4, she had double pneumonia with scarlet fever, which left her paralyzed with polio. The doctor said she could never walk again. Her mother encouraged her. She told her, with God-given ability, persistence, and faith, you can do anything you wanted. Wilma told, I want to become the fastest woman on the track on this earth. At the age of 9, she removed her braces against the recommendations of her doctor and took that first step that the doctor said she never would. At the age of 13, she entered her first race and came way, way last. And then she entered her second, third, and fourth races and came very, very last, until the day came when she came in first. At the age of 15, Wilma went to meet Coach Ed Temple at Tennessee State University. She told him, I want to become the fastest woman on the track on this earth. Ed Temple replied, with your spirit, nothing can stop you. Besides, I will help you. The day came when Wilma Rudolph was representing the United States of America in 1960 at the Olympics. In the Olympics, you're matched against the best of the best. Wilma was pitted against a woman called Jutta Hain from Germany, who had never been beaten. The first event was a 100-meter race. Wilma beat Jutta Hain and won her first gold medal. The second event was a 200-meter race. The result was indifferent. Wilma beat Jutta Hain yet again and won her second gold medal. The third event was a 4x100-meter relay. In a relay, the fastest runners anchored their respective teams. Wilma and Jutta anchored their respective teams. The first three runners ran and changed batons easily. When it was Wilma's turn to take the baton, she dropped the baton. But when she saw Jutta Hain speed past her at the other end of the track, she picked up the baton, shot like a bullet, and reached the end of the track before Jutta Hain did and claimed her third gold medal of the Olympics. It became history that a paralytic woman had become the world's fastest woman on the track, undisputedly. What a lesson Wilma's life tells us. It tells us successful people do it in spite of and not in the absence of failure. When I was in school, I was pampered with all the good things that my parents could afford. When I was in class 11, my parents bought me the All India Pre-Medical Pre-Dental Examination Preparation Kit so that I could use it and prepare it to become a doctor. But I was procrastinating things. I did not prepare as well as I should have. The result, I did not become a doctor in the end. What happened was, as the higher secondary examinations neared, I could see the milkman, the newsletter boy, or the newspaper boy, the temple priest, friends, relatives, well-wishers, everyone around me seemed to have one common objective in life. They wanted me to become a doctor. The pressure of everyone wanting me to become a doctor was too much for me. I could not handle the pressure. I thought I could do it next year. I could write an improvement exam and take it to the next year and get into a medical college. When my friends were burning midnight oil trying to get that elusive seat in their dream college, I was happily thinking that I would do it the next year. The higher secondary results came. I had scored an ordinary 75%. When people around me could not have even digested 95%, I had scored 75%. The devastation was not that. It came after the results. There was a case filed in the Madras High Court asking to disallow students from writing improvement exams to improve their results. My parents were visibly devastated. I did not know what to do. My father was not going to allow my career to go into crisis. He forcefully made me join an engineering college. I did not want to become an engineer. I never wanted to become an engineer. The course of my life had taken an inflection point at that point. When I entered engineering college, I could not concentrate on studies. I was completely distressed. I thought I had done something completely wrong. I thought I had not done justice to my parents. I had not done justice to my own talent. I did not know what to do. I was at complete loss. It was then that I managed to sit and think about my current situation. I thought the only way I could restore some lost pride was through studies. Opportunity presented itself in the form of the first semester examinations after 4 months. I had prepared with every sinew in my body with a singular focus of achieving excellence. The results came. I had scored a very satisfying 87%, bagging the zone's top score. The smile was back on my parents' faces. I was feeling comfortable again, and from that moment on, I never took my foot off the gas. Setbacks are inevitable in life. A setback can act as a driving force and also help us learn humility. In defeat, we can learn faith and courage to overcome setbacks. You cannot allow defeats to intimidate you. When life hits you hard, there's no point in taking the blow and lying low. Rebound, and feel good. Your inflection point could just be after your biggest defeat. If you think you'll lose, you're lost. If you think you're done, you are. Success is in the mind. Success begins in the mind. Success doesn't always go to the stronger and faster man, but sooner or later, the man who wins is the man who thinks he can.